Okay, I'm Joel Rutherford. I'm the carpentry instructor here at Muscle Shoals Career Academy in Muscle Shoals, Alabama. And this video is designed to be used in my class. It's going to cover what's called basic safety. This to be used by my students to complete their classwork. The instructions for this module are as follows. Students are to complete the basic safety worksheet that is associated with this lesson as they watch this video. The worksheet will count as a quiz grade, and the test that's associated with this lesson will consist of 30 multiple choice questions, and it will count as a major test grade. Students that are absent on the day we take the test have the responsibility for making that test up themselves. The objectives for this lesson are as follows. We're going to talk about the importance of safety in the construction industry, as well as in some manufacturing and industrial environments. We're going to talk about safe work requirements for working on elevated surfaces. We're going to talk about struck by and caught in between hazards. We're going to talk about some electrical hazards as well. We're going to talk a little bit about lockout, tagout. We'll get into some personal protective equipment, and we're also going to talk about some other specific job site safety standards. Safe behavior is not something that humans are born with. Safe behavior is something that has to be learned. And that's why safety training is so important, because it's not something that people know automatically. It's something they have to learn. Now, a culture can be defined as the shared attitudes, values, or beliefs of a particular organization or group of people. Now, a safety culture, or a good safety culture, is created when a group of people, an organization, or a company sees and believes in the value of having a safe work environment and also safe work practices. A company that has a good safety culture enjoys fewer at-risk behaviors, they have lower accident rates, less turnover, so they have fewer employees leaving, they have less lower absenteeism, and also higher productivity. Okay, our text defines an accident as an unplanned event that results in personal injury or property damage. So basically, it's something that happened, it wasn't expected, it wasn't planned, and either someone was hurt or some property was damaged in some way or another. A near miss is obviously different than an accident. A near miss is defined by our text as an unplanned event or occurrence in which no one was injured and no property was damaged, but someone could have been injured or property could have been damaged. So a near miss, something almost happened, an accident, something did happen. Okay, and there's several different causes of accidents. Poor work habits. Lack of skill, unsafe acts, intentional acts, alcohol or drug use. All of these can be causes of accidents. Okay, poor work habits. This slide gives us an example of poor work habits on the left, and on the right it has an example of good work habits. You can see that this guy on the left is bending over and he's lifting this box using his back muscles. And we all know that that's a very good way to injure your back. So this is just something he does. It's probably a habit, and he doesn't even think about it. The guy on the right, he's lifting correctly. He's using good work habits. That's going to keep him from injuring his back lifting in that manner. Another cause of accidents is unsafe conditions. Unsafe condition is a state that is different from the acceptable safe condition found on the job site. Examples of this may be poor lighting, inadequate machine guarding, excessive noise, Poor housekeeping is another good example of an unsafe condition. Here's another example of some unsafe working conditions. You can see this masonry saw right here is missing a guard. That's an unsafe work condition. All of this trash and construction debris that's over here, that's an unsafe working condition. There are multiple trip hazards over here behind where this guy is doing his work operations that could cause him to become injured. So this is just a good example of a bad condition. Housekeeping is so important when we're talking about staying safe. Good housekeeping means that you're just keeping your work area neat and organized. Doing this is going to prevent accidents. Here's an example of poor housekeeping. All of this debris that's laying around there, there's really not any trash or anything like that, but it's just all of these materials that these guys are using to do their job have been left laying all around the job site, and it creates trip hazards, and it creates the possibility and potential for accidents. Let's talk a little bit about OSHA now. OSHA stands for the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, and this is the federal entity that was set up to ensure that Americans are safe while they're at their job. Now, one thing that is very important when we're talking about keeping a job site or a work environment safe is a risk assessment. A risk assessment is a measure of the probability, consequences, and exposure related to an event. And a lot of times these are used in anticipation of a possible accident to determine what could happen, and thereby we're able to determine how to mitigate the risks involved with a certain job. Part of a risk assessment is a job safety analysis. A job safety analysis is where a larger task is broken down into individual parts or steps, and each of those steps is analyzed to determine the potential risks involved with that step. When we understand the risks involved with a step, we can also think about ways that we can mitigate or lessen the risk of someone getting hurt while performing that task. Now, this is a very simple job safety analysis that I want to walk you through here. And the job that we're doing is changing the blade on a circular saw. Like I said, it's very simple, not a lot to it, but this is just designed to give you an idea of what a job safety analysis is. Okay, so right here at the top of this form, it's just got some areas where you can fill out, and that way we know who did this job safety analysis, when it was performed, what the job is, and these can be very different from one form to the next. Here on this left-hand side is where this larger task of changing a circular saw blade has been broken down into smaller steps. The middle column is where we have identified the potential accidents involved with the individual steps. And the right-hand column is where we have listed ways that we can mitigate the risk. So starting off at the beginning, when you change the blade on a circular saw, you start by unplugging it. And there is a small possibility that you could be shocked when you do this. So the way what we've got to do in this right-hand column is think about how can we mitigate the risk of being shocked. And the way we do that is by being careful and wearing gloves. The second step is going to be to lock the blade. Now, I can't think of a hazard or possible accident that would stem from locking the blade on a circular saw, because it's essentially just pressing a button. So the potential accidents there are pretty much negligible. Now the next step is going to be loosening the bolt. Now, there's a possibility when we loosen this bolt that holds that saw blade on, that that wrench could slip. We could slam our knuckles into the blade. We could be cut. We could bruise our knuckles. A couple of different things that can happen there. So, to keep that from happening, we're going to be careful, take our time, and again, we're going to wear gloves. Next, we're going to take the old blade off. There is a possibility that we could cut our hands on this old blade, so we're going to wear gloves, right? And the next step is to install the new blade. Well, again, this wrench could slip and we could bruise or cut our knuckles, so we're going to wear gloves. So, like I said, that's a very simple example of a job safety analysis, but nevertheless, I think it does a good job of showing us the process of analyzing a job and hopefully taking most of, if not all of, the risk out of doing a job. Now, OSHA has its own definition for a competent person, and that's very different from the definition that we use just in everyday life for a competent person. OSHA defines a competent person as a person who has the training and experience needed to identify hazards, but this person also has the authority needed to make decisions related to the job site. So it's not enough that somebody's got experience and knowledge. They also have to have authority. And most times, to be deemed a competent person, a person has to complete some sort of OSHA training that would give them the skills and knowledge needed to make those calls. OSHA also has what's called the Focus Four. And basically what this is the four categories into which most construction-related accidents fall. Now on this slide, we see where I have listed the Focus Four. The first one of the Focus Four is falls. That could be falls when somebody's just walking across the job site and trips on something, or it could also be falling from a ladder or falling from the second, third, fourth story of a building. The second is struck by. That could mean you are struck by a falling object because there's somebody working overhead, or you could be struck by a nail that was shot out of a nail gun. You could be struck by a piece of equipment. The third is caught in or caught between. So a person could be caught in a piece of equipment and injured that way, or they could be caught between a moving vehicle or some other kind of moving apparatus that's used in an industrial setting. And the fourth of the Focus Four is electrical shock. And we're going to talk about some of these going forward. Fall protection is a very big issue, and it's always a point of concern in the construction business because falls from elevated surfaces is one of the leading causes of fatalities among construction workers. And that's why OSHA places a special emphasis on fall protection. There are lots of different standards that govern fall protection in the construction industry, but a good rule of thumb is this: a harness should be worn if your feet are 6 feet or more off the ground and you're not protected by guardrails. That's not a universal rule or anything like that. It's just a good rule of thumb when you're in the construction business. Holes. A lot of times in the construction job sites, there are areas that must be left open to lower stories. One example of this is an elevator shaft. Another example might be a stairway. And these holes can't be plugged up until the building's complete. So there's a period of time when you've just got an open hole there on your construction job. So that's a very big deal. People can fall through there and be killed. To keep that from happening, holes should be covered and labeled. And these guys have done a very good job here. They've covered it up with some plywood that looks like some 3/4 thick plywood, and they've also got it barricaded. So good job there. That's how those should look. I also like how they've got stay off hole there, so everybody knows what that is. Okay, a safety harness. A safety harness is designed to stop a person from falling from an elevation. We're going to talk more about these going forward. Safety harnesses should be inspected monthly by a competent person, and the D-ring that is in back of a safety harness should always be in the middle of the person's back, so that if they do fall, they have maximum opportunity to not be hurt. Now, there's a couple of different types of lanyards that come on these safety harnesses. This lanyard here on the left-hand side is a non-shock absorbing lanyard. And what this would be used for would be positioning only. So for instance, if a person is working near an exposed edge where there's not a guardrail, what might happen is that they use this lanyard to tie themselves off to keep them from getting too close to that edge and possibly falling. On the right hand side, we have what's called a shock absorbing lanyard, and you can see the shock absorbing portion of the lanyard is right here. Okay, and what's going to happen is if this guy falls while wearing that shock absorbing lanyard, this part of the lanyard is going to expand almost like a rubber band, and it's going to cushion his fall so that he doesn't get hurt by the harness itself. So two different types of lanyards there and two different uses. Okay, ladders. The main rule that we need to remember about ladders is that the distance from the building to the foot of the ladder should be 1/4 of the distance that has to be climbed. That will keep a good safe angle on that ladder and keep this thing from possibly turning over and flipping somebody off of there backwards. Another rule regarding ladders is that ladders should always extend at least 3 feet above where the ladder touches the surface. And finally, the highest safe standing level on an extension ladder is the 4th rung from the top. So, right there. Now, there's a lot of OSHA standards that govern scaffolding. There's lots of different types of scaffolds, but we're going to talk just a little bit about a very simple handrail that would go on just your standard scaffold. Now, first off, you're going to notice that OSHA requires posts be 8 feet apart at maximum. So the most they can be apart is 8 feet. Also, there has to be a top rail, a mid rail, and a toe kick. Now, the top rail should be 42 inches plus or minus 3 above the walking or working level, and it should be able to support a lateral force of 200 pounds. The mid rail should be halfway between the working surface and the top rail and should be able to support 150 pounds of lateral force. And finally, the toe board, it should be 3.5 inches tall, which is the width of a 2x4, and should be able to withstand a 50 pound lateral force. One of the main reasons for having a toe board is to keep tools and materials from being kicked off of the scaffold and falling down and hitting people on the ground below. Another way that we can keep tools and materials from falling is by using debris nets or even canopies. Now, this next section is on trenches and excavations. This is something that is very terrifying to me. Just the idea of being in a hole and having that hole cave in on you is just a very stressful thought to me. So we're going to talk about that for a few minutes. Now, a trench is a type of excavation. It's kind of a specialized excavation, and it's specialized in that a trench is deeper than it is wide. So that's what would differentiate a trench from just a standard excavation. Trenches and excavations are both dangerous. Some of the hazards associated with these are cave-ins, water accumulating and falling objects over into the excavation, and finally hazardous atmospheres that can be created by toxic gases trapped in the soil. Okay, now here's an example of where water has accumulated in a trench. And this can be dangerous in a couple of ways, especially if there are workers in the trench that are using electric tools. You've got electricity mixed with water, which is never a good situation. Also, this water that has accumulated in the trench is going to leach up into the walls of the trench and soften it and increase the likelihood of a cave-in. OSHA requires that excavations and trenches be inspected daily by a competent person. And remember, a competent person is someone who has the experience and training needed to identify hazards, but they also have to have the authority to make decisions and changes related to the hazards that they encounter. One of the main considerations when we're talking about excavations and trenches is the soil type. The soil type plays a pivotal role in the prevention and identification of potential cave-ins. There's three types of soil. Type A is a fine-grained, it's sticky, particles are too small to see with the naked eye. Here in Alabama, we have red clay, and it is very stable. It sticks together. It is the most stable of the soils. There's also type B, which has, it's a type A, but it also has rocks and some silt in it as well, and it's not as stable as type A. Finally, there's type C. This is coarse grain, sandy, gravelly soil. Particles can be seen with the naked eye, and this is the least stable of the soils. This is so unstable, as a matter of fact, it can't be benched. It has got to be sloped back, and we'll talk a little bit about that in just a minute. Anytime you're working around an excavation and you don't know what type of soil you're dealing with, it's always best just to treat the soil as if it were type C. There are a lot of construction companies out there that treat all soil like soil C. And I think that's a very smart and sensible way to manage that process. Now, this is an example of benching. And what's happened here is workers need to work down here on this bottom level of this excavation. So what the company has done is just benched the side of this trench back. Rather than just digging straight down to this level, they've benched back here, and that lessens the likelihood of a cave-in. This is an example of sloping. You can see that the workers need to work at this level, so what the company's done is just sloped the edges of this trench back so that workers can get in there and work safely. As I mentioned before, type C soils must be sloped. They cannot be benched. Okay, now OSHA also has some very specific rules regarding means of egress. And what means of egress is just a method of exit. If workers are in a trench, they have to have a ladder or means of egress within 25 feet of them at all times. So if you have a 50-foot trench and you have one ladder right in the middle of the trench, you have satisfied the OSHA regulations. I would also go as far to say it'd be a very smart move and a very sensible move to go ahead and have several means of egress handy So that way, you know, it's a safer situation for the workers. Another way that excavations and trenches are made safe is by using a trench box. And you can see by looking at this picture here, this trench box, it's right here, this red thing right here. And what's happened is this guy on the track hoe dug a trench, then used the track hoe to set that trench box down into the trench. And now the guys can get in here and they can do their work. If the soil does cave over or cave in, it's just going to go up against this trench box and stop. It's not going to hurt these guys inside it. And what they'll do is they move on down the trench. This guy in the track hoe will continue to dig, and he can just grab that trench box with his hoe on his machine and pull it on down through the trench, and the guys can get in there and do their work. I put this in here. This is not really an OSHA violation. This is just something that I see from time to time at the beach. These guys have, I guess just because of boredom, dug this huge hole in the sand at the beach. And they've all gotten down in there. This is very, very dangerous. Very dangerous. This hole could cave in on these guys and it'd kill all six of them before they could get them out. I put that in there because all my students are of high school age, and many of them go to the beach on summer vacation, and I just wanted to put that in there and make sure everybody knows how dangerous this behavior is. Doing this, you're basically putting your life at risk if there were a cave-in. Okay, let's talk a little bit about electrical hazards. Approximately 86 people died from electrical-related accidents in the construction industry in 2018. One of the ways that we could have avoided those deaths, and probably did avoid many more, is by using this three-wire system. And this is pretty universal nowadays. What it is the cords have three prongs on them. One prong is a hot, one is white, and that's a neutral side, and the third is a ground, and it usually has a green wire running to it. Sometimes it has a bare wire with no insulation on it at all. And the purpose of that third wire is to protect workers from electrical shock. If that tool is ever damaged, the current should pass to the ground wire and instead of into the body of the person using the cord. This is a very common system, and it's used for protection against accidental electric shock. Okay, here we see an example of an unsafe cord and a safe cord on the right hand side. These on the left only have the two prongs on them. Somebody has taken the prong out of this one and made it into a two prong situation. These are dangerous. These cords need to be taken out of service. Over here, we have a good example. You can see it still has all three prongs: the hot, the neutral, and the ground on it. Ground fault circuit interrupters. These are also called GFCIs, and they're designed to prevent electrical shock by cutting the flow of electricity off when there is a difference in the currents in the hot and neutral wire. So when you're operating a tool, you should have the exact same amount of current coming back through the neutral as is passing through the tool through the hot wire. And anytime there's a difference in these two currents, that GFCI will trip in just a millisecond and cut the flow of electricity. This is designed to make the tool safer and hopefully not have as many injuries as a result of that. Here we have an example of two GFCIs on the left. These are very common in houses and commercial buildings. These are common on construction sites. This is the GFCI right here. This plugs into the wall. The tools are plugged into this side, and thereby the tools are GFCI protected. Okay, polarized electrical receptacles. These are made to be used with double insulated tools. Essentially, what you've got here is you've got your neutral side on the receptacle is a little bit larger than the hot side, and that corresponds to the tools having a larger prong on the neutral side and a smaller one on the hot side. That way you can't plug this tool in backwards. So that's just a safety device, and those are designed to be used with double insulated tools. Pretty much all tools that are on the market today are double insulated. There may be some older tools out there that are still in use that are not double insulated, but by and large, all tools these days are double insulated. Okay, this slide talks a little bit about lockout tagout. Lockout tagout is a system that protects workers from the release of hazardous energy while they're working with machines and equipment. So in other words, if a maintenance person or other worker needs to perform some maintenance duties on a piece of machinery, it could be a pump, or it could be some sort of electric motor. It could be anything. The worker has a lock that they will put on the energy supply after turning the energy supply off. That lock is supposed to be removed by the worker that put it on there only. So what happens is a worker will be working on, will disconnect the power to the machinery that they're going to be working on. They put their lock on it, then they can go work on it and know that somebody's not going to come behind them and turn the power supply back on to that machine while they're working on it. Employers take this lockout tagout procedures very, very seriously. It's very common for employees to be fired for violating lockout tagout procedures. This is an example of a lock, and you can see that this guy, it's got his picture on it, has put his lock on this disconnect after having turned it off. So that ensures that whatever piece of machinery is being, would normally be supplied by this disconnect, is not being supplied any of electricity so that he can work on that piece of machinery safely. Now this is a close-up of one of these tags, and you can see it's got this guy's picture on it. He would put his name here and the department where he works. The other side says do not remove this tag and padlock. The only person that should remove this personal lock and tag is the person that applied it. So this is very common in construction and industrial environments, and it's something that you guys will most likely encounter at some point during your careers. Now, let's talk a little bit about personal protective equipment, or PPE. We're just going to hit the highlights of this subject. We're by no means going to get into all the different types of PPE that's out there. We're going to hit about four or five different types of PPE, and then we're going to move on. The first one is gloves. Gloves are used to protect our hands from sharp objects, but it is a terrible idea to use gloves when you're going to be working around machinery that has moving parts, because the gloves can very easily get caught in the moving parts and pull the person's hand into those moving parts. Another use for rubber gloves is to prevent the person wearing them from being exposed to bloodborne pathogens like hepatitis. Obviously, these types of gloves need to be rubber, and they need to be tested as well to make sure they don't have holes in them. And the way you test them is to just blow air into them and squeeze them, And if the air comes out, you know there's a hole in the glove somewhere. So that's a very big deal. Another type of PPE is hard hats. Hard hats should always be made of fiberglass or reinforced plastic. You never want to have a conductive hard hat, because if it encounters electricity, you can be shocked and suffer brain damage, possibly, if the shock is large enough. Now, OSHA requires hard hat usage only where there is a danger of falling objects. A lot of companies, I think most companies, require their construction workers to wear hard hats 100% of the time. But, you know, either way, I'm just telling you the minimum OSHA requirements. With regard to hearing protection, a really good rule of thumb is that if you need to raise your voice to be able to speak to someone that's 2 feet away, you probably need to be wearing hearing protection. Hearing protection is a really big deal to me. I always, almost always, use my hearing protection because I just don't want to lose my hearing. Now, there are several different types of respirators. If we're in a situation where we're trying to protect ourselves from dust or other larger particles, a half mask or a mouthpiece with a mechanical filter is sufficient to protect us from that. If we're trying to protect ourselves from dangerous gases, we might want to use what's called a SCBA, self-contained breathing apparatus. If we're going to be exposed to dangerous gases for just a short period of time, we can probably get by with a full face piece that has chemical canisters. But that you would not want to be exposed to those gases for very long at all if all you had was the chemical canisters. Let's talk a little bit about lead. Lead is a element that can be very dangerous and can cause serious health problems if it gets into the bloodstream of a human being. Lead was banned in 1978, but it still is present in some older buildings and machinery that was constructed prior to 1978. The most common source of lead is in paint. So if you're ever working on a piece of old machinery, if it was painted prior to 1978, there's a very good chance it was painted with lead paint. And if you start sanding or working on that piece of equipment and you start disturbing that paint, that lead is getting into the air. And when you breathe, you take that lead into your body. And that can be very serious and can cause some very serious health problems. So anytime there's a possibility that you may be working on something that's painted with lead paint or has some other lead in it, you always need to use your PPE and make sure that you protect yourself. MSDS. Okay, MSDS stands for Material Safety Data Sheets. This is just a data sheet that comes with a chemical shipment or a shipment of any other kind of material that's used in an industrial environment. The MSDS outlines the safety concerns for the chemicals. Employers are required to keep an MSDS for every chemical or hazardous material that they have on their job site. Employers are also required to ensure that the employees have access to this MSDS information, and they're also responsible for making sure that they're aware of it and know where to locate it. MSDS sheets contain lots of information. They talk about the permissible exposure limits. They identify the substance. They'll talk about first aid procedures related to exposures to this whatever chemical it is. And MSDS sheets are very easy to find. All you have to do is type in the name of the chemical and MSDS into any internet search engine, and it should pop right up. Now, this is an example of an MSDS for some iron oxide pigments. And you can see it's got the manufacturer's name here. It's got their address, got their phone number, and their fax number here. It has got some, it's got a description of the chemical. Says there are no significant risk factors with this product. It's telling us what to expect in case the product is inhaled, what to expect if it comes in contact with skin, if you get it in your eyes, or if you happen to get it in your mouth. And it is also telling us that it is not a carcinogen, so it doesn't cause cancer. So that's just kind of the broad strokes on what an MSDS sheet is. If you look up here at the top of this one, there's actually a 4-page MSDS for these pigments. But nevertheless, it's kind of the same. There's a lot more information. I'm just giving you the broad strokes. Asbestos is a chemical, or it's a product that was used to make a lot of different materials in the 70s. And exposure, especially long-term exposure to asbestos, causes a type of lung cancer, mesothelioma. If there's ever a potential of workers being exposed to asbestos, they should wear a respirator before they disturb the asbestos. And really, asbestos is only harmful if it's disturbed. If you were dealing with some tile that was made from asbestos, as long as that tile is sitting there and it's not being scraped or disturbed in any way, it's not going to hurt you. When you get in there and you start breaking those products up and it becomes friable, and the little particles of asbestos get into the air, that's when it becomes dangerous, but only then. Next, we're going to talk a little bit about heat stroke. Heat stroke is caused when your body overheats because of physical exertion in high temperatures. Heat stroke requires emergency treatment, and it can be life-threatening. Heat stroke and heat exhaustion are two different things. Heat exhaustion is just when a person gets overheated. They may be nauseous. They'll be sweaty, may get dizzy. Their skin may get kind of cold and clammy, and there's a slightly elevated body temperature. With heat stroke, the body temperature will be extremely elevated. The person will have a headache. The skin, they will stop sweating. They may be confused. They may not. If you're suffering from heat stroke, your vision may become impaired. Heat stroke can be fatal, so you always want to be very careful with any kind of heat exhaustion or heat stroke. When we're working around welding, there's obviously for persons that are taking part in welding activities, there's some very specific PPE that has got to be worn to keep the person welding from getting burned. But sometimes what gets missed is people that are working in close proximity to those that are welding. They can also be burned by those ultraviolet lights. Their eyes can be burned, and it creates a dangerous situation. So one way to protect people that are not welding but are working in the vicinity of welding activities is to put up welding shields or curtains. And if you look here at this yellow curtain that is that's there to block those ultraviolet rays and protect those workers that are nearby but are not actually welding. When we're talking about materials handling and stacking materials, we got to remember that if we stack our materials too high, then that creates an unstable stack, and those that can fall and hurt people and even kill people. The OSHA requires that a ratio of 4-to-1 height to base ratio when we're stacking materials. Anything more than that creates a dangerous situation. With fire extinguishers, there's several different types of fire extinguishers. We're going to talk about four of them here. The first one is Class A, and Class A fire extinguishers are designed for wood, paper, cloth, just ordinary combustibles. And the way to remember that that's Class A is to remember that when wood and paper is burned, it leaves behind ashes. So that should help us remember Class A. Class B is more for flammable liquids, gas, kerosene, oil, things of that nature. So when we think Class B, let's think of bubbles, and that will remind us that Class B is used on flammable liquids. Class C is used for electrical fires. A good way to remember that is to think Class C, you think of charge, and that will remind us that Class C is to be used on electrical fires. Finally, D is for combustible metals like magnesium and some things like that. And a good way to remember that is when we think of Class D, think of dent, and that will help us remember that Class D is used for combustible metals. Most fire extinguishers that you'll encounter are ABC fire extinguishers. So they are effective on ordinary combustibles, flammable liquids, and live electrical equipment. When we're using a fire extinguisher, we want to remember the acronym PASS. That stands for pull, aim, squeeze, and sweep. So what we want to do is we're going to pull the pin and hold the unit upright. Then we're going to aim at the base of the fire. It's important that we spray the chemicals at the base of the fire in order to put the fire out. Then we're going to squeeze the lever. And then when we squeeze the lever, the fire will initially flare up. But if we keep squeezing it and spraying it, it will quickly go out. And the final S stands for sweep the nozzle from side to side. Okay, a confined space is defined as a tank or other workspace that's large enough to work inside of, but it has limited means of entry or egress. Egress meaning exit. Confined spaces have poor ventilation, generally speaking, and this presents a hazard to workers. Because the confined space has poor ventilation, the work and the confined space needs to be inspected by a competent person prior to the work. And that competent person will issue an entry permit, which allows workers to go inside of this confined space and perform their work activities. You should never go inside of a confined space without having been issued a permit. And that concludes the basic safety lesson. Just to go back over the directions, this worksheet that goes along with this instructional video is going to count as a quiz grade. We will be having a test over this material as well. The test will consist of 30 multiple choice questions. If you've completed the worksheet using Google Docs, it's very important that you use red text. I will not accept anything other than red text when you are completing this using Google Docs. And finally, just a reminder, if you are absent on the day we take this test, then it's going to be your responsibility to make the test up. So you'll just need to get with me and remind me that you need to complete your test. That's it. I hope you all have learned something from watching this instructional video. If you have any questions, please feel free to email me or come by and see me. Thank you very much.